Okay, so Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So we are now starting this third lecture on deep learning. And today we are still covering this topic of foundation of artificial neural networks. Okay. So last class ke andar jo hai na, we talked about this cost function, the class that we had 2 days ago. So we were discussing this issue of gradient descent. Okay, so what you need to remember is that in the case of deep learning, what we have is that at the output we get some values, right? We might be having binary neurons at the output or the sigmoid neurons. So if it is a perceptron network, then primarily we have the binary neurons, but primarily we are using the sigmoid networks or sigmoid neurons mostly. So I'm getting some sort of output at the output layer. Okay. So we need to basically understand that we always have three types of layers, the input layer, the output layer, and we have one or more hidden layers in between. That is that should be clear. Okay, so we get some output at the output layer and it is almost always like in the case of supervised learning, it's like a predictive problem. So if we are talking about classification of handwritten digits, so that's a predictive problem. So I'm getting some sort of output at the output layer and I want to compare that with the actual output. So we have a predicted output and we have an actual output in the case of classification. We do have deep learning algorithms which do unsupervised learning. For example, generative models based on autoencoders and GANs. So GANs, generative adversarial networks. So they are basically used for unsupervised learning tasks. Okay, so they generate images, they can generate data, they can generate images. So that is more of an... Obviously, training deep learning is one of the most difficult things in computer science. Training, obviously, you need to train a neural network, and that's what we have to understand today. But I'm just talking about the different types of models that we have. Primarily, we are dealing with classification tasks in deep learning. ज़्यादातर जो हमारा काम है वो लाइक इमेज क्लासिफिकेशन इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट फेमस एप्लीकेशंस इन डीप लर्निंग. सो इफ यू राइट अ हैंड रिटन चेक, ओके, एंड यू वांट अ सिस्टम टू रिकॉग्नाइज द चेक एंड देन डिपॉजिट और क्रेडिट डेबिट अकॉर्डिंग टू व्हाट इज इन द चेक, सो दैट शुड बी डन ऑटोनोमसली एंड दैट इज बीइंग डन. बट यू शुड हैव अ सिस्टम विच शुड बी एबल टू एक्यूरेटली रिकॉग्नाइज द टेक्स्ट विच इज रिटन ऑन द चेक. Okay, so that's one of the applications of deep learning, one of the old applications of deep learning. Okay, so what happens is that in the case of classification tasks, which are very common in deep learning ki zyadatar applications are based on the you can say image classification, recognition of images, recognition of different things. Okay, so in that case, I have some sort of output at the end. I have a actual output, which I always predict at vector yx. In the case of machine learning one, you saw that we associate y as the target. So y is what we already know. And what comes out of the output layer is actually the vector a. So a is not just one number. So remember that in the output layer, I can have more than one neuron, like we were discussing in the last class. So I can have, let's say, three neurons in the output layer. So I'm going to have three values of activations, A1, A2, A3. One activation value for each layer. Achha, isme just remember the convention ke A is the output of the sigmoid or the activation function. When you, kya kehte hain, what comes out of the sigmoid function, we label that as A. So every neuron has an activation function. Typically, the whole each layer has its own activation function. You can define that as a separate activation function, but normally we can take just one activation function for the whole neural network. Okay, so hum is tarah nahi karte ke first hidden layer mein linear activation, second hidden layer mein ReLU, third hidden layer mein sigmoid. We don't do that because if you use just one activation function, it is easier to control the outputs, you can say. Okay, it is easier to learn the values of weights and biases. Okay, so first let's try to understand the basic concept. Okay, so what comes out of the sigmoid function or the activation function, we call that as A. Okay, so and what goes into the sigmoid function, the activation function, or a neuron, you can say, because when I say an activation function, I mean a neuron. The activation function is applied at each neuron except the input layer. The input layer is just a linear activation, so it just passes on the input to the first hidden layer. Okay, so there is no processing at the input layer. So besides the input layer, I have hidden layers and output layer. So at each neuron of the input layer and of the hidden layer, and at each neuron of the output layer, I am applying an activation function. That activation function typically is the same. Normally we use the sigmoid or the hyperbolic tangent, but we can also use the ReLU function, which is used quite commonly in convolutional neural networks. Okay. So there is an input to a neuron and there is an output to a neuron. The output to a neuron is called A. Okay, we call that as A. So okay, you must know that every neuron must have some sort of subscript and superscript, depending ke wo kaun sa number ka neuron hai and depending ke wo kis layer ke andar hai. So there must be a subscript and a superscript. So we will do that later on. Right now I'm just talking about the general concept. Okay, so what goes out of the neuron is called the A, the activation value. In the case of sigmoid, what is going to be A? What is the range of A? Between 0 and 1. And in the case of perceptron, either 0 or 1. In the case of perceptron, either 0 or 1. In the case of sigmoid, between 0 and 1. Okay. So, but what goes into the sigmoid function? Is sigmoid function ki jo जो आप सिग्मॉइड फंक्शन को जो चीजें दे रहे हैं उसकी बेस पे तो आउटपुट कंप्यूट होगा जो सिग्मा है तो दैट इज कॉल्ड वी कॉल दैट एज जेड एंड दैट इज द वेटेड इनपुट व्हाई वी कॉल दैट एज वेटेड इनपुट वी विल सी दैट डाउन द रोड ठीक है बट एक्चुअली व्हाट हैपेंस इज के लाइक लेट्स से कि आई हैव दिस न्यूरॉन इन एनी लेयर ओके एंड देयर आर लाइक लेट्स से कि थ्री न्यूरॉन्स इन द प्रीवियस लेयर व्हिच आर inputting to this neuron. Okay, so what is going to be the weighted input of this neuron? The activation coming out of here multiplied by the weight plus the bias. So let's say A1 W1 plus A2 W2 plus A3 W3 plus B is the weighted input, which we call as Z vector. No. Every neuron has just one bias. The bias is for the input. No. The bias is a separate input which we put on each neuron besides the input layer to have some control over the wave the neural network is behaving. It's just sort of external feedback. Ji.
Ye jo addition of smart is that mandatory ya main bias ko let's say data ko bias ko plus na karu main multiply karu mera bias hai mono
मैंने लास्ट क्लास में ही बताया था कि द बायस इज एक्चुअली डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम द परसेप्ट्रॉन रूल I told you in the last class that the perceptron ka jo rule hai na, W1x1 plus W2x2 = 0. So the bias is actually derived from there. So when we apply the sigmoid neuron, so usme phir hum, we bring in the biases. The bias is derived from there. So it is actually a negative value, but when we take it to the next side, the general equation of the and A is called the based on the values of the input hyperparameters. I gave that example in the last class, right? So I have thousands, I might have thousands or hundreds of hyperparameters in my deep learning network. Kitne weights ho sakte, kitne biases ho sakte. So the only way I can do learning is to ensure that if I change the values of the hyperparameters, then the value of cost will change. Conviction that if I change the values of hyperparameters, then the value of cost will change. First, I need this. So if I am multiplying the weighted input by a constant, it will not make any difference to the cost. We saw that as an exercise. The cost will vary, but it is not going to vary like we want the cost to always go negative. We have to play some tricks to make the cost always come down on this curve. Okay, that is what gradient descent and backpropagation is all about. The cost should always come down based on the values of partial derivatives that we compute. So for that to happen, we need a formalism, we need a mathematical formalism in which I am sure that if I change the values of weights and biases, then at the end, at the output layer, definitely it is going to make an impact on the value of the cost. That is a conviction. So by multiplying the values of bias, that is not going to make any difference. It is just going to increase the magnitude, but it is not going to make the ball come down. It might increase in magnitude, but it is not going to make the ball come down. On the contrary, if I add the bias here, the bias, look, if the bias is a negative value, then the system will learn. The job of the system is to learn the values of weights and biases. I cannot specify the bias myself. I just put in the bias as a control parameter so that the system has more flexibility in controlling the cost. If I only leave it up to the weights, it was not working good. It was not working well for our tasks. So they introduced the concept of bias. So when each neuron has its bias and we allow the system to learn the value of the bias itself, then they found out that we have more control over making the cost negative and controlling the cost and minimizing the cost. That is the thing. So bias does not mean that I am specifying, how can I specify the value? There is no way we can specify the value. We can only tell the range, okay, you can vary between 0 and 1 if we want things to remain according to standard normal distribution. But there's no way we can specify. What we can specify are things like the learning rate and whether we want to do some particular normalization or not. That's what we can specify. But we have in no way we can control the bias values of hundreds to thousands of neurons. We just put it there. And we found out that makes the system more flexible to learning, and it makes the system learn fast, and it does make the system converge. Okay, is this thing clear? So you need to be very clear on the concepts. Okay, G. We will only initialize the values of weights and biases randomly according to the standard normal distribution. That's it. After that, we run the backpropagation algorithm. Abhi hamara maksad ye hai ki we understand ki how things are working. You should understand the notation. You should understand the basic concept. What is weighted input? What is the activation? What is the error that we're trying to control? How the partial derivatives are going to contribute to minimizing the cost on this curve. That's what you need to understand, okay? What happens at the inside is a very complicated system of linear equations, which we can't solve. That's why we leave it to the network to solve it through backpropagation. Hamare bas ki baat nahi hai ki hum usko baith ke automatically, autonomously learn the values of hundreds of weights and biases through solving thousands of equations. We can't do it. So we need an algorithm for that. Okay. Yeah, we just, just remember, I'll just write it down there. Just remember ke for any neuron other than the input layer to just to take the input. Okay. For any neuron in the hidden layer and in the output layer, any neuron. What comes at the input is called Z, which is the weighted input. And what comes out is the activation, because this neuron is basically applying the activation function. Currently, we're assuming this is the sigmoid function, but we can have many other functions as well. Input layer just passes the input to the first hidden layer. The same input. Yeah, there is no activation function at the input layer. Okay. So what comes out, in this case, we are labeling that as A. If you read some other book, maybe they will use some other notation, but that's the notation we are using. What comes out is A, what goes in is the weighted input, which is Z. Okay. So if I want to write that in terms of vector for the whole layer, so A equals to sigma Z. If I'm using the hyperbolic tangent function, then A equals to tan H of Z. Depends on the function. If I am using the ReLU function, A equals to ReLU of Z or leaky ReLU or whatever. Okay. So there's a whole family of activation functions which also allow you to control the way cost varies. Typically, hum sigmoid function is to use karte hain because it gives me a lot of flexibility in how the ball rolls down. That is why I use a sigmoid function. But there are other functions also which you can use, which might be better in some cases than the sigmoid function. So so partial derivatives, shape of the valley and the direction in which our ball should roll. So whenever I take the derivative of a function, what does that represent? How that function derivative I always take with respect to some variable of the function, right? So in this case, the cost function, I have a cost function, right? And the cost function is being defined by which variables? All the weights and all the biases. So we are representing that by this one. So if I derivate the cost with respect to all the weights, so I'm going to have hundreds to thousands of derivatives. So what is that telling me? How the cost is changing with respect to, that is what I want. That is what I want. That's what I was explaining to you. Okay. I want the cost to be varying with respect to each weight. And I want the cost to change with respect to each bias because I want to control the cost to always go down. If this relationship is not there, then how can I control? Okay, so that's the logic here. So here YX is what we already know, actual output. A is what comes out of the, so A in this case means the activation of the whole output layer. It's a vector. So if the output layer contains, let's say, three neurons, so that is primarily A1, A2, A3 or whatever subscript aapne usko assign kiya. So I'm calling A as the vector of three activations, 1, 2, 3, which are the three activations here. So I'm representing this in a vector notation. Whenever you use the vector notation, it becomes easy for you. Sorry? YX is the actual output, jiske saath aapne A ko compare karna. Like MNIST. MNIST mein actual output hai and the one is the output which comes out. Okay, so let's proceed. We are just on the first slide. Right, so this is from the last lecture, in fact, so I'm just recapping a bit. All of you understand this? Okay, tell me why we are using a quadratic cost function. कुछ हद तक सही है जी आदिल, मैंने नहीं कहा था, आप बताएं कि आपके समझ में क्या है. तो नेगेटिव आ भी जाए तो क्या है, हम तो वैसे भी चाह रहे हैं कि कॉस्ट नेगेटिव हो. हाँ कुछ हद तक. ठीक है, हाँ, that makes it more concrete. Actually, the quadratic cost function will obviously be a quadratic curve, either in 4D, 3D, 1D or 100D. It's going to have a quadratic shape. And when you have a quadratic shape, then it becomes easy to do gradient descent and reach the minimum point. That's the main thing. So what we want the weights and biases to affect the cost, DC by DW and DC by DB. We want these to have concrete values, right? So that can be achieved when we have the quadratic cost function. If I have a cost function, okay, number of correct classifications, so that's a very linear type of linear type of cost function, which does not have that shape, which will allow me to do gradient descent properly. That's what I explained in the last class. Okay, so please keep this in mind. Similarly, I can have a cubic function. Cubic function is going to complicate things. Why? It can have multiple peaks and troughs. So it can get stuck in local minima or whatever. Okay. Quadratic mein to, in this case, there is only one. Okay. So cubic ke mukable mein quadratic is better. So you will see this example. That's why in most. Achha, so this is what we want. Ke I want to move the ball a small amount, delta V1 or delta W1, in the direction of the weight, because weight is a vector. Okay, so vector has a direction, and a small amount of the other parameter. In this way, I move a small amount according to each weight and each bias. So whenever the ball moves, the ball will move according to the movement of the ball in each direction of all the hyperparameters. So keep that in mind. Okay, the cost is going to change. For example, look, there is going to be delta C, which is approximately equal to, which is this explained, ke, the rate of change of the cost with respect to V1 multiplied by the change, because basically delta C equals to delta V1 plus delta V2. Basically, it's that, right? That's the basic equation. But delta V1 is changing with respect to the rate of change. Bhai, ek insaan jitni jaldi bhaag sakta hai, utna hi bhaagega na. Someone can run very fast, someone can run very slow. So maybe V1 is changing very fast, C is changing very fast with respect to V1, and C is changing very slow with respect to V2. So it's going to be according to that. Change to aayega. Every hyperparameter is going to change, but it is going to change according to its rate of change. Every hyperparameter is going to change, but it is going to change with respect to its rate of change. So if I ask all of you to start running, so maybe Dr. Valiullah can be the first one because he's tall and thin, so he can run very fast. I will be the last one, but all of us are changing, right? All of us are changing. We are changing our positions, but someone is changing very fast. Someone is changing very slow. So the change is always with respect to the rate of change. That is why we have multiplied the partial derivative by the delta of that particular parameter. These are just examples. You can consider them as weights and biases. ये तो सिर्फ एक एग्जांपल आपको दी है समझाने के लिए. That's it. हाँ देखें इसमें ये कि हाँ let's because It's like when the ball is here, for example, the ball is here. So I move in the direction of V1, okay? And then I also move in the direction of V2, which is something like this. So I have to take the approximate position of these. Okay, yahan bhi move kiya, yahan bhi move kiya. So what is the, like I compute the hypotenuse of a right angle triangle. So I went here and I went in this direction, I went in this direction. So basically, I went here like this.
So would it be?
Hey, don't consider it like that. This is not. I think this is the actually X is the number of training. X represents each training instance. So I am computing the cost for each training instance. N is the total number of training instances, but X is the data for that training instance. So that's why I have YX minus A. So every time I present an input, I have a YX and I have an A. I compute this. So that is not what we are. But you are asking is that I have this position. And let's say I have 100 parameters in my deep learning network. So I will have delta. How many deltas I'm going to have? I'm going to have 100 deltas. Okay. So 100 deltas mean I can move in 100 different directions if I can visualize 100 D. वैसे तो 4D से भी ऊपर विजुलाइज करना मुश्किल है, बट लेट्स अज्यूम के आई कैन मूव इन 100 डिफरेंट डायरेक्शंस, स्मॉल स्मॉल स्टेप्स, एंड देन व्हाट इज गोइंग टू बी द इफेक्ट ऑन द कॉस्ट, दैट इज गोइंग टू बी द रिजल्टेंट ऑफ ऑल दोस चेंजेस. थोड़ा सा यहां, थोड़ा सा इधर, तो उन सब का रिजल्टेंट इफेक्ट क्या होगा, दैट इज गोइंग टू बी द चेंज इन कॉस्ट. So that is the formula here. The actual delta C, the actual delta C is going to be highly dependent, or it is going to be estimated based on this for all the hyperparameters. DC by DW1 multiplied by delta W1 plus DC by DW2 multiplied by delta W2 for all the weights. नहीं, जितने वेट्स होंगे और जितने बायसेस होंगे उतनी ही आई एम गोइंग टू हैव दीज टर्म्स. दैट्स व्हाट आई एम सेइंग के द कॉस्ट इज वेरिंग विद रिस्पेक्ट टू ईच वेट एंड ईच बायस. द कॉस्ट इज वेरिंग विद रिस्पेक्ट टू ईच वेट एंड ईच बायस. आई वॉन्ट टू कंट्रोल द कॉस्ट. द ओनली वे टू डू दैट इज टू टेक पार्शियल डेरिवेटिव्स of the cost with respect to each hyperparameter. Okay, so how can I estimate how much the cost will change? And that is can only be done through this formula. So if you want an example, just wait.
My assumption is that the cost is being affected by each weight and each bias. And we can prove that mathematically as well. Okay, when I have this cost function, then I have A, I can represent A in the form of Z, and Z will include W, X, and B. So basically, I can represent the cost as a function of weight and bias. So that is what is written here. Ye to maine aasani ke liye yahan pe likha hua, to make you understand its activation. But the activation is computed through weights and biases, the weighted input. So I am representing the cost as a function of weights and biases. So my assumption is that the cost is always going to be affected by each weight and each bias. That is the basic assumption of deep learning or neural network learning. So now how can we ensure that this happens? So I am saying, cost changes with respect to each weight and each bias. That is happening because that is what is happening. Yx is a constant. That's what we already know. Yx has nothing to do with it. The only way cost can change is through the weights and bias. Okay. So now how can you formalize that? So I want a formula to measure the change in cost. Based on the change in hyperparameter. Okay, is this clear? Okay, I want a mathematical formalism in which I can change the cost based on the changes of the hyperparameters. Okay, हमारी पहली बात क्या की? Cost is varying with respect to weights and bias only. X भी आपके पास गिवन है, y भी गिवन है, The only thing which is controlling the cost are weights and biases. So now how can I develop the formalism? The formalism develop karne ke liye pehli baat kya hai? Ke I want a formalism in which I can measure the change of cost with respect to the change of the variables, because that's my assumption. The change of W and B is affecting the cost. So I want to formalize that so that I can minimize the change. Okay, I can minimize the cost. So for that, the equation that we use is this one. Okay, the change of cost is this equation. Okay. The change of cost is being affected by each hyperparameter. So on the right side of this equation, I'm going to have each hyperparameter. So yeah, because every hyperparameter, whether it's a weight or a bias, is affecting the cost. Is the baat clear? Okay. So I must have the contribution of each hyperparameter at the right side of this equation, which is written here, in order to measure the change of cost. That's what is happening here. But what should be the contribution? So I write it like this: A B C over D W one into delta W one. Plus so on and so forth. Now, by this, ideally speaking, what should we have? We should have this. Delta C can be estimated by delta W1 plus delta W2 plus delta W3 and so on up to delta Wn plus delta V1 up to delta Vn. Okay, ideally, we should have this. The cost is being influenced by all the changes. The change in cost is being affected by or can be estimated by the changes of all the hyperparameters. That's what I told you. Whenever we say we are rolling down the valley, so I'm moving in each direction of the hyperparameter. And the cost ka jo change hai, wo resultant changes. So it's a sum of all the vector changes. Okay. So but now, what I am telling you is every hyperparameter is not changing at the same rate. I gave you the example of running. I gave you the example of recovery. If two people are suffering from the same disease and are taking the same medicine, one of them will recover definitely earlier and the other will recover 2 or 3 days later. So the rate of change of recovery is different for each patient. Similarly, the rate of change of each hyperparameter is different for each other. That is why we have to include the term partial derivative. That is the reason we compute the partial derivative, because our assumption is that the rate of change of each hyperparameter is different. Okay, theek hai, aap change ho jao, you can change, but you have to change with respect to your rate of change. Okay, so now this equation should be crystal clear to you why we are having this. And how many terms we are going to have on the right hand side? As many weights and biases we have. Total number of weights and biases, utni terms. Huh? In the whole neural network, besides the input layer. Haan, usme three. Okay. The input layer se hidden layer pe jo ja rahe hai na, input layer se hidden layer pe jo. Main input pe we are just going to pass the input values. That's the thing. Digitized image. So there are going to be weights there. The connections between the input and the first hidden layer, they are going to have the weights. Okay. Okay, delta V1 and delta V2 should be chosen so that now this is our condition. Now we have defined the formalism. Okay, now our next task is what? To ensure that delta C goes down, is negative. Okay, so for this, we put just in notation. So delta V, we represent that as the vector of all the changes. And inverted triangle C as the vector of the partial derivative. So I can write this equation as this.
Okay, you look clear.
It's just the vector form, which makes it simpler. So in the paper also, in the hourlies, if you want, you can go for individual parameters, but you can write the vector form to demonstrate ki aapko uski concept ki understanding hai. Okay? So
So this is pretty clear, okay? So we have to make delta C negative. And now we talked about this in the last class, ke, let's assume ke I make this substitution. I create this myself. I introduce a hyperparameter, which I call as eta, which is, I write this eta as this italicized n sort of, ठीक है इसको क्या कहते हैं eta. So I introduce this ke I want in this equation I want to replace delta v by minus eta of inverted c, which is the vector of partial derivatives. Inverted c is the vector of partial derivatives and v is the vector of changes. Okay, so I replace delta v by this term janbujhke for some particular purpose. Okay, so when I do the replacement, then I get the change of cost is equal to this term. Sahi hai na bhai, maine idhar delta v ko maine sirf isse replace kar diya hai. So inverted c square ho jayega and I'm going to have the negative eta. Okay, so now delta change of cost is equals to negative of the eta, which is what we call the learning rate. Okay, and obviously I take the partial derivatives for main dekhen abhi sirf sawal ka jawab hai abhi sir jawab theek hai. What does this equation tell me? Delta C change of cost equals to negative of the learning rate multiplied by the partial derivative square. Partial derivative is going to give you a numerical value. DC by DW1 is going to give you a number. Every partial derivative is a number and every delta is also a number. So these are numbers, right? Huh? So what is the benefit of this equation? Delta C is always going to be negative because inverted C square is always going to be positive. So partial derivative ki koi bhi value ho, change of cost is going to come down. That's what we wanted. So this is an intelligent substitution and this is called the learning rate. Why it is called the learning rate? I am controlling the rate of change of each hyperparameter with respect to the change in cost based on the learning rate. The learning rate is helping me to associate the rate of change of any hyperparameter with respect to the total cost. So the learning rate turns out to be a very powerful parameter. Because this is the association which I want. I want to associate the change of cost with respect to the partial derivatives. कि तुम weight के हिसाब से change हो रहा है, bias के हिसाब से change हो रहे हैं, उसके हिसाब से cost को change होना चाहिए. That's the initial assumption we have, right? कि जिस हिसाब से जितने आपके गाड़ी के चारों tire worn down हैं, उतनी ही आपकी गाड़ी चलने में परफॉर्मेंस अपना खराब करेगी. सो द परफॉर्मेंस द रनिंग परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ योर कार इज डिपेंडेंट ऑन द परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ फोर टायर्स. सो एग्रीगेट परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ योर कार इज द रिजल्टेंट ऑफ द परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ ईच ऑफ योर टायर्स. ये वो वाली एग्जांपल है. सो आई वांटेड आई हैव दिस इक्वेशन द लर्निंग रेट इज हेल्पिंग मी कनेक्ट द कंडीशन ऑफ योर टायर्स विद द परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ माई कार. Connect the rate of change of each hyperparameter with the change in cost function, which is what we want. Hamara maqsad hi yahi hai ki parameter ke change ke sath cost ke change ko kisi tarah humne jodna hai is tarah se ke cost niche chale. That is it. That is the basic concept you need to keep in mind, and that is being given to us by this formula. It's not that simple, वैसे. अभी तो कहानी शुरू हुई नहीं है, लेकिन if you understand this, then I think the future slides will become easy. ठीक है? Future slides वो वैसे आपका बैक टू द फ्यूचर ही हो जाएगा, क्योंकि आप कहेंगे वो नहीं समझ में आया, फिर ये नहीं समझ में आया, तो इट्स गोइंग टू बी ठीक है जी। चले अच्छी बात है, बहुत अच्छी बात है सबके लिए। सो बाय मॉडिफाइंग द वैल्यू ऑफ डेल्टा वी, वी कैन एंश्योर दैट द बॉल रोल्स ऑन द कॉस्ट स्लोप टिल द मिनिमम पॉइंट। सो आई मेक अ सब्स्टिट्यूशन फॉर डेल्टा वी इन एन इंटेलिजेंट वे एंड दैट इज गोइंग टू एंश्योर कि इट गोज डाउन। सो डेल्टा वी, अब दिस नोटेशन जस्ट गेट कंफर्टेबल विद दिस के वी, हां मैं सामने आ रहा हूं, जस्ट एक्सप्लेन दिस। वी को कन्वर्ट करो, वी इज गोइंग टू नाउ चेंज, एरो मींस द वी इज गोइंग टू चेंज इनटू वी डैश। वी डैश मींस के द न्यू वैल्यू ऑफ वी, एंड व्हेन वी डू ग्रेडियंट डिसेंट बैक प्रोपगेशन विद ग्रेडियंट डिसेंट देन वी हैव टू अपडेट द वैल्यू ऑफ weights and biases at each training instance or at each batch, ठीक है? वो तो हम देखते हैं, batch का मतलब क्या है, mini batch का मतलब क्या है, epoch का मतलब क्या है, we'll see right now, ठीक है? के तो I will have W1 or you can use this formalism के you can say के W1 old, W1 new, you can also use that or you can say W1 dash equals to W1 whatever, ठीक है? So the new value of V is going to be the old value. This is always the case for all the hyperparameters also. Okay, the new value of W1 is going to be the old value of W1 plus or minus something. Okay, so minus N delta C, because that is the substitution we are making. We said okay, we are going to change V like this. So we are going to, from the current value of V, we are going to subtract this term, which is a substitution that we want, because we are saying that delta V is this. What is delta V? V, delta V, what does it mean? The new value of V minus the old value of V equals to this. So that's what we have done here. The new value of V minus the old value of V equals to minus N. Okay. Delta V means the new value of V minus this. So this is equal to minus N inverted C. So I just take the V here and this. So in this way, W1 dash equals to W1 minus this, for example. A W2 dash equals to W2 minus this. W3 dash equals to W3 minus this. Where W3 is the old value and W3 dash is the new value. This is how we update the weights and biases. Yahan tak basic concept clear? I just repeat these things here for your own knowledge. So in this way, ab dekhe na, abhi hum ye kaam keh rahe hain ki input a value, output the cost. For each training instance, I'm going to have some output and I'm going to have some error or the cost. Error and the cost is the same thing. But in our example today, error is something else, cost is something else. So cost is something which is coming at the output layer. So we are always going to use the term cost now. Some people also use the function J to represent the cost. Okay, and we are using the notation C. We are using this notation. So don't get confused by, okay, cost means cost at the output layer. That is the difference between the actual and the predicted. Jo bhi aaya, okay, whatever. So what we are assuming this, okay, I am inputting an instance. I'm getting something at the output. I'm computing the cost. And based on the cost, I'm updating the weight. Okay. Again, I input the second instance. I get the cost. Based on that cost, I do backpropagation with gradient descent. I update the weights. So this is what I'm assuming right now. So repeatedly compute the partial derivatives and move in the opposite direction. So this is because of the negative term, saying move in the opposite direction. The learning rate needs to be small enough. This is also explained in the last class. If the learning rate is very high, what is going to happen? Delta V will be high. Delta V will be high. We don't want a high jump right now because we want to control the cost. We actually want the cost to go down. We don't want the individual hyperparameters to start jumping. ठीक है, वो तो हमारा काम कंट्रोल में नहीं रहेगा फिर. So therefore, we can't have a very high value of eta. Otherwise, The change in cost is something jo ke negative nahi rahega. It can go towards the positive side as well. Theek hai? Matlab wo niche ke kareeb aake phir upar jaane shuru ho jayegi. So what I mean to say is ke if you have a very high value of, so you are here, and if you have very high value of learning parameter, maybe you reach here very close to the minimum and then you go up again. So the cost rises again. We never reach the minimum. Yes, initially we start with a high learning rate and then we exponentially or logarithmically taper it down. It's between 0 and 1. So it's basically we start with like 0.9 or 0.7 or 0.8 something. And then we taper it down as the learning increases. जैसे जैसे आपका cost curve नीचे जाता रहता है, we keep on decreasing the learning rate as well. Because if we don't do it, then this situation can happen के cost can start going up again. ठीक है? So, and n also, and if n is too small, अगर बहुत ही कम है, then learning will be very slow. Learning will be very slow because the learning rate, so learning rate is 0.001, so learning will be very slow. Weights will update themselves after a long time and it might take maybe 3 or 4 hours before you can get the output. So therefore we have to maintain a balance. Yeah. So C is a function of, let's say these are M variables, and this is just notation, delta C produced by a change in delta V. So in our case now, we are not bothered anymore with V, we are just assuming weights and biases, okay? So this is just a notation which is written here. So this is what we wrote in the last slide. This is what we already know. So this technique is called gradient descent. I am descending based on the gradient. What is the gradient? The partial derivative. That is what is called gradient descent. So that's the partial derivatives are the gradient. So I am basically going down the valley, based on a negative gradient, based on descending my gradient, which is called gradient descent. Okay? So in practice, gradient descent often works extremely well. And the gradient descent approach with the backpropagation algorithm, obviously, is the primary form of learning in all neural networks of deep learning. Okay? Recurrent neural networks, I have an extension of this, which is called backpropagation through time. BPTT, backpropagation through time, but it's still the backpropagation. So backpropagation, we have different variants which have come up, backpropagation in the last few years. So that is more of a research side. Okay. Acha, ye kya kaha hai proof? Ek minute. Constrain the move so that delta V magnitude equals to eta, or eta greater than zero. Okay, so if I am saying okay, you can change, W1 can change, W2 can change, but the change is going to be, what am I doing here? What is this equation? Bhai, aap change ho jaye, lekin change in a particular range. Aapka maximum change should be equal to this. It should not be greater than this. If the, let's say eta is 0.05. Let's say it is, so W1 ki current value, let's say it is 0.9. So W1 dash at the most can be 0.95. This is just a hypothesis. Hum ye keh rahe hain ki learning rate ko bhi control karna hai. Let's say I put a control on the amount of running that you can do. Kitna bhaag sakte ho? Bhai yahan se leke wahan tak bhaagna hai bas. You don't have to run all the way to the main game. So I'm saying ki you can change. You have to change, obviously. But isse zyada change nahi kar sakte. Let's say I put this restriction. With this knowledge, prove that the choice of delta V, which minimizes this, is this, where n equals to this. कौन इसको प्रूफ करेगा? बोर्ड पे आ जाएं, बोर्ड पे आके खुद कर लें, इसमें क्या? choice of delta V which minimizes. Okay, let me just stop the recording here. Yeah. In this case, those people who are online, please try to come in the class. We saw initially that we made this substitution delta V equals to minus N inverted C. Now we are just making a bound on that, an upper bound. This always has to be less than or equal to eta. Okay, so in this equation, if I substitute delta V with this one, and then I can substitute minus eta with E over delta C. Basically, it is proved that when I make this substitution, then the cost is always going to go down. Here it is always, here he's only asking me to put eta as the upper bound. That's it. Ye to hum already proof kar chuke hain ke minus eta inverted C ke upar the cost is going to go down. So already proven. Yeah, it's also written ki constrain the move. No, it can't be exactly equal to that. How can it be exactly equal? When we give a confidence interval, what we are doing, we are giving a range in which we are confident, 95% confidence, for example, that the predicted value is going to lie in this particular range. We can never constrain anything equal to itna hi aapne change hona hai. This is the upper bound. They are just asking, they just asked a very innovative question. We already made a substitution for delta V. Just equate that with eta as the upper bound. That's it. That's what they want. And using that equation, minus eta ko wahan replace kar dein. You are going to be left with this change of cost equals to partial derivative multiplied by eta. What does this tell you, USA? ये तो इक्वेशन अभी हमने देखी है डेल्टा सी इज अप्रोक्सीमेटली इक्वल्स टू द पार्शियल डेरिवेटिव विद रिस्पेक्ट टू ईटा इट्स द सेम थिंग बिकॉज यहां पर क्या था पहले इट वाज डेल्टा वी नाउ आई एम रिप्लेसिंग डेल्टा वी बाय ईटा एज द अपर बाउंड कि डेल्टा वी की वैल्यू ईटा से ज्यादा नहीं जानी चाहिए तो आई जस्ट पुट ईटा देयर सो दिस इज द मैक्सिमम डेल्टा सी दैट वी कैन हैव बट इट इज स्टिल गोइंग टू बी नेगेटिव Because, so this is ये upper bound की calculation है ना actually तो we are using the learning rate parameter this is the calculation for the upper bound कि maximum इतना होगा नहीं it is देखें डेल्टा सी का पॉजिटिव होना मसला नहीं है डेल्टा सी का पॉजिटिव होना मसला है बात यह है कि इट इज गिविंग यू द अमाउंट बाय विच सी चेंजेस आपको दे रहा है कि सी किस अमाउंट से चेंज हो रहा है ठीक है सो दैट इज व्हाट वी वांट टू कंट्रोल इट इज डेल्टा सी इट इज नॉट द एक्चुअल वैल्यू ऑफ सी इट इज द डेल्टा सी के इतना सा हम उस पर बस एक बाउंड लगाना चाह रहे हैं दैट्स व्हाट इट इज सेइंग मैक्सिमम बाउंड देना चाह रहे हैं उसको कि मैक्सिमम तुम इतना चेंज हो सकते हो एक्चुअल वैल्यू तो लर्निंग रेट से डिसाइड होगी दैट इज मैंने वहां लिखा है कि लेस देन और इक्वल टू ईटा मैंने इक्वल टू ईटा नहीं किया उसको आई सेड के माइनस ईटा इनटू इनवर्टेड सी इज लेस देन और इक्वल टू ईटा क्या कहेंगे उसको एप्सिलॉन ये फिर आप मुझे बाद में ईमेल वगैरह कर दीजिएगा ऐसा बहुत टाइम लग जाएगा फिर यहाँ पे दे आर जस्ट आस्किंग अ सब्स्टिट्यूशन वी नो दैट दिस सब्स्टिट्यूशन वर्क्स सो आई अकॉर्डिंग टू माय नॉलेज आई एम जस्ट पुटिंग एन अपर बाउंड ऑफ एप्सिलॉन ऑन दिस दैट्स इट ठीक है कि ये है और जब इसकी सब्स्टिट्यूशन हम करेंगे तो द ओनली वे आई कैन प्रूव दिस सब्स्टिट्यूशन इज थ्रू दिस फॉर्मूला दैट्स इट ये तो कह रहे हैं कि ये प्रूव करो दिस कैन ओनली बी डन थ्रू दिस फॉर्मूला और कैसे करेंगे आप सो इन दैट्स व्हाई आई एम सेइंग इट्स एन अपर बाउंड इवन दो इट सीम्स पॉजिटिव बट इट्स एन अपर बाउंड Okay. अच्छा नहीं वेयर एन इक्वल्स टू अगर इसमें मैं ईटा ओवर दिस तो दिस इज नेगेटिव इनफैक्ट भाई
हाँ तो माइनस साइन रिमेंस टू बी देयर
हाँ तो माइनस डाल भूल गया था तो माइनस भूल गया बस बाकी तो सही है तो आप कह देते ना माइनस मिस हो गया बस ठीक है चले बारह बहरहाल वो सब्स्टिट्यूशन वाली बात तो समझ में आनी चाहिए थी सबको ठीक है ये तो जरूरी था हैं ठीक है वो ओके लर्निंग विद ग्रेडियंट डिसेंट ओके राइट सो इट्स द सेम थिंग हियर सो हाँ ये एक हाँ एक्चुअली ओके 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 आप लोगों को एक बात मैंने बताई नहीं दिस इज कॉल्ड दी कॉशी इनइक्वालिटी Cauchy Schuller inequality, something like that. So I think if we had to use this in solving this. So it means ke the multiplication of two vectors, unka jo individual sum hai is greater than or equal to their sum. This one. So this is the Cauchy Schuller inequality, something like that. So if I have delta V equals to Why not? In this case, this is C. This is whatever. Let's say I have just one weight W1. That's it. Not even biased. Okay? So when C. Okay, we are having two different answers to this. One is that we can find out the minimum point directly by differentiating this equation, which is just based on one variable. And the other response is that we have to do the gradient descent, but it is expected to converge faster in both the cases. So if you are able to prove your answer in a good way, then there's no hard and fast rule. Okay. Then, abhi main kaha break le le 10 minutes. We have not even started the actual stuff. Really? Chale, theek hai, aap log break leke aa jaye. Okay, we are back now after the break. So, wo aaye? Kya kehte hain? Apna Ghazi? So the number of partial derivatives we know now is going to grow exponentially with the number of variables. ठीक है ना ये तो अब हमें कुछ इसको देखना पड़ेगा it's computationally intractable. Calculation computationally उसको ऊपर ही बिल्कुल ना Computational intractable is going to take a long time to compute. Computationally not feasible. So that is why we apply this gradient descent approach. So we'll see how that happens. So basically, this is the weight update equation jo ki maine aapko batai thi. I gave you this equation for the general case, but V ke liye humne equation likhi thi. It's going to be exactly that. The new weight is going to be the old weight minus the learning rate multiplied by its partial derivative. Okay. And similarly for the bias. So these are the set of equations which are going to be generated for each weight and each bias. Okay. Achha, there is one thing, ke right now the scenario is such that we have the cost. I present one training instance and I compute the cost and then I update the weights, which are thousands of weights. Then I present the other training instance, then I compute the cost and then I again update the weights. Abhi hum is scenario ki baat kar rahe hain. The point is ke this is definitely very heavy process. Ke if I have, let's say, 60,000 images, so I have to present the input 60,000 times, and 60,000 times I am computing the cost, and 60,000 times I am updating all the weights and computing thousands of partial derivatives at each in training instance. So that is definitely computationally intractable. So I have to do something about that, right? So one of the things that you need to keep in mind, that I can compute the average cost over a certain number of training instances. So abhi to humne baat kiya ki ke I am computing the cost for each training instance separately. Yehi baat ki hai na. But if I say ki I am going to present 100 images and then I am going to take the average cost and then I am going to update the weights. So I'm not going to update the weights and biases after every training instance, but I'm going to update the weights and biases after a set of training instances. Har training instance pe weight update karenge, to I have to compute thousands of partial derivatives at each instance. That's not feasible for me. Baharal, just understand this concept of the average cost. I can compute the average cost over a number of training instances. And to compute this inverted C, calculate the gradient for each training example and then average them as in the above equation. So delta C is approximately equal to inverted C and delta W, for example. That's I'm talking about the weights, okay? So hum ye baat karein ke I will not update the cost at each training instance. I will update the cost after a certain number of training instances have passed. So for that, I will use the concept of average. I will take the average of all the partial derivatives and I will take the average of the cost for each training instance. So yes, Samajwari, so it will become clear later on. So we use the concept of stochastic gradient descent. We will see what that means. Ke stochastic gradient descent ka kya matlab hai? Gradient descent to ye hai ki training instance, compute cost, compute partial derivatives, update the weights and biases. Training instance, compute cost, compute partial derivatives, update the weights and biases for each training instance. Stochastic mein ye hai ki I basically don't do that on each training instance. I do it after a number of training instances has passed so that I can minimize my work. Otherwise it becomes computationally intractable. If at each training instance I have to update thousands of weights and thousands of biases, then obviously the calculation is going to take, I don't know how many days. So that's why we use stochastic gradient descent. Theek hai, isko itna concept abhi yaad rakhein, theek hai? Okay, stochastic mein what happens is ke estimate inverted C, which is the vector of partial derivatives. Inverted C ka matlab hai the vector of all the partial derivatives. And you see with respect to all the weights and C with respect to all the biases. By computing it, delta Cx, inverted Cx, for dhyan rakhiyega, small number of randomly chosen training inputs. So I will be having 60,000 training inputs. Like MNIST ke andar mere paas training data kitna hai? MNIST mein training images kitne hain? Parso bataya tha aap logon ko. Lecture ko revise kar. 60,000. I have 60,000 training data images and how many tests? 10,000 test images. Okay.
So
what I'm going to do is I'm not going to train the system on all the 60,000 images in sequence.
मैं ये नहीं करूँगा कि चलो भाई शुरू हो जाओ 1, 2, 3, 4, 1000, 1001, 1002
all the way up to 60,000 और हर instance के ऊपर मैं weight update कर रहा हूँ. I'm not going to do that. Okay? What I'm going to do, I'm going to select a small number of randomly chosen training images from the 60,000. Let's say I select 100 or 200 or 32 or 64 or 500, but not 60,000. Okay, I just select a small number of random training inputs and I call that as the mini batch. What do they say? Mini batch. So let's say I am taking M of the images. So what is this equation telling me? Yes. Why? The point is I have 6,000 images. I take a mini batch and update the weights according to that. Mini batch mein to main har instance pe kar sakta hun. Or I can do it after the whole mini batch. By the way, the cost to mujhe har step pe compute karni padegi na. I have to compute the cost at each training instance, but I can update the weights after the mini batch is over, or I can update the weights after each training instance. लेकिन चूंकि मिनी बैच है तो लिहाजा मैं हर ट्रेनिंग इंस्टेंस के बाद भी वेट्स को अपडेट कर सकता हूं. इट्स ओके. सो 60,000 में से मैंने लेट से बैच लिया 30 का, विच इज नथिंग. रैंडमली 30 का लिया, वेट्स अपडेट कर दिए. फिर रैंडमली एक और मिनी बैच लिया, वेट्स अपडेट कर दिए. रैंडमली एक और मिनी बैच लिया, फिर वेट्स अपडेट कर दिए. सो आई एम नॉट डूइंग द सीक्वेंशियल 60,000, रादर आई एम टेकिंग रैंडम बैचेस ऑफ रैंडम मिनी बैचेस of the training data and updating my weights according to the mini batch, weights and biases. And my assumption is that if I do that a certain number of times, like maybe if I repeat this exercise 40 times or 50 times, then my delta C is going to converge to the actual delta C, which would have been the case if I had taken everything sequentially. आप कर ले 60,000 पे. आई हैव टू मेक अ रैंडम सिलेक्शन ऑफ मिनी बैचेस, राइट? दुनिया में लाखों लोग एमनिस्ट पे काम कर रहे हैं एंड एवरीवन इज डूइंग एसजीडी बेस्ड ऑन रैंडम सिलेक्शन. सो डाइवर्सिटी तो होनी चाहिए ना. द मोर ट्रेनिंग डेटा यू हैव, द मोर कॉन्फिडेंट यू फील अबाउट द रिजल्ट्स. बट जस्ट डाइवर्सिटी, किसी को नीचे से सिलेक्ट करेगा, किसी को ऊपर से करेगा, सही है? So, यहां पे क्या लिखा हुआ है? This is the averaged, the cost averaged over all the instances of the mini batch. हर मिनी बैच में जितने भी इंस्टेंस थे सबकी कॉस्ट आपने निकाली, उसका एवरेज जो है दैट इज अप्रोक्सीमेटली इक्वल टू दी, सॉरी नॉट दी एवरेज, नॉट दी कॉस्ट, दिस इज दी पार्शियल डेरिवेटिव. दी पार्शियल डेरिवेटिव वैल्यूज, the rates of change of all the weights and biases for each instance in the mini batch is equal to the value of the partial derivative vector if I had used all the 60,000 images together. That is my assumption. Why this assumption is true? नहीं, रिप्रेजेंटेशन तो होनी चाहिए. ये कौन, मेरे ख्याल में ये सेंट्रल लिमिट थ्योरम है. व्हाट इज द सेंट्रल लिमिट थ्योरम? हु विल टेल मी? The average behavior of a number of samples converges to a normal distribution. average behavior or the aggregate behavior. So in this case, we are basically doing the aggregate and the average. So it seems to be an application of that. Yeah, I'm saying ke I have 60,000 images. If I take many batches 50 times, many batches of let's say 100 images 50 times, then the overall the value of the partial derivative vector, which is inverted C, which means the partial derivative values of all the weights and all the vectors and all the biases, converges to the partial derivative vector if I had used all the 60,000 images. That's what it means, right? This is the delta inverted C, meaning that I use all the training instances. So I'm saying that this can be approximated, iska sign matlab hai, this can be approximated by this. Shart ye hai ki you don't take one mini batch, you obviously take lots and lots of mini batches. But mini batches are more computationally tractable as compared to the sequential method jo ki hum pehle discuss kare. Hence, we can estimate the overall gradient by computing gradients just for the randomly chosen mini batches. Right? Say. So SGD goes on like this. Pick a badge, pick a mini badge, and update as shown above. What is update as shown above? This thing. Ye jo weights ka jo basic equation that we have already derived, right? Old weight, new weight equals to old weight minus the learning grade multiplied by its partial derivative. That's the formula for weight update and the bias update. Theek hai? Theek hai, samajh aayi? So mini badge mein just update. Then we pick out an other randomly chosen mini batch and train with those. Again, we update the weights. Okay. And so on until we have exhausted the training inputs, which is set to complete an epoch of training. So epoch ka kya matlab hota hai? Epoch means ke you epoch in neural network means ke a set of mini badges. So one epoch mein you can take 30 mini badges. Because so 60,000 images hai yaar. तो 30 अगर आप एक मिनी बैच में 100 ले रहे हैं तो 30 तो कुछ भी नहीं है. यू जस्ट कवर 3000, उसमें से भी रेपिटेशन हो सकती है. सो मे बी यू कैन टेक 50 मिनी बैचेस और 100 मिनी बैचेस, आई डोंट नो. यू सी कि आपकी वो परफॉर्मेंस किस तरह आएगी. तो द आइडिया इज के फॉर एंड दैट कंप्लीट्स वन एपॉक एंड देन यू कैन रन द एपॉक अगेन एंड अगेन एंड अगेन. सो यू कैन हैव इन वन एपॉक आई कैन हैव मल्टीपल मिनी बैचेस and I can have multiple epochs as well. Until the point is ki cost should go down. That's it. When I'm sure ki the cost will not go down further, then I can stop the training. Any epoch khatam hone se pehle, I can even terminate the training. We, in each iteration, we record the cost, the cost of the previous iteration, and compare with the cost of this iteration. If that is less than a particular threshold, we stop. We can say 0.005 is the threshold, or 0.05 G. Sorry? 30 samples, 30 instances. Yeah, we can update the weights and biases after every training instance. Yeah. नहीं देखें, ट्रेनिंग इंस्टेंस तो इज एन इमेज इन एमनिस्ट, राइट? इट्स द डेटा विच कम्स एट द इनपुट लेयर. वेट्स एंड बायसेस, द नंबर ऑफ वेट्स एंड बायसेस इज डिफाइंड बाय द आर्किटेक्चर विच यू हैव चोजन. कितने वेट्स हैं, कितने बायसेस हैं, इज डिफाइंड बाय द आर्किटेक्चर विच यू हैव चोजन. तो लेट मी जस्ट, अगर मैं आपको एक
And then I'll have the output layer. Output layer, how many neurons? 10.
me I have a fully connected neuron. The fully connected means that every neuron in the neuron layer is going to be connected to every neuron in that layer. So how many lines is that going to generate? 784 if you see. So 2342. यहाँ तो 2342 मिल चुके हैं.
Assume what happens. So the question being asked is, do we update the weights after presenting each training instance, or do we update the weights after the mini batch? What should happen? क्या करना चाहिए? नहीं, आपने data, you input the data, okay? You have some cost. You have to compute the cost for that instance, right? So you just stick there with the cost. आपने cost को बस आपने cost save कर ली, right? Then you present the other instance and compute the cost. In this way, you present the whole mini batch and compute the cost. So let's say कि 30 का mini batch था, तो 30 cost मेरे पास आ गए. ठीक है, 30 cost values आ गई. I have the cost formula as well. So what will happen? I take the average of that cost. I take the average cost, and then I update the weights. Can I do that? Yes. Yes, I can do that. But can I also update the weights after every instance? I can also do that, but that is going to take a lot of time. And in deep learning, ये देखा गया है कि barring the time series problems, time series को हटा के, if you update after every instance, then the performance might not be good. So you update after the mini batch. है? Performance का मतलब accuracy, obviously. In this case, accuracy because we're talking about image classification. ये हमने खुद personally experiment करके देखा है. मैं इसलिए आपको बता रहा हूँ कि updating when you have lots and lots of images and lots of epochs. Even though अगर आप SGD कर रहे हैं mini batches के साथ. So updating the weights after every training instance will take a lot of time. I might not converge as fast as updating the weights after the presentation of a mini batch. सही है? जी. Yes, a mini batch. ठीक है, after mini batch. ठीक है, सही है. And so when the epoch is finished, we can start over with the new training epoch. The size M has to be determined in advance. Size M क्या चीज है? हाँ, the number of mini batch size. ठीक है. For example, if a training set N is 60K and M equals to 10, so we can have a 6,000 times speed up in estimating the gradient. The mini batch की वजह से there's going to be a lot of speed up. In estimating the gradient, because we don't have to estimate the gradient for 60,000 images, we just have to do it for 10. Okay. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. Doesn't have to be perfect. Doesn't have to be perfect because we just want the cost to decrease. So, हम बहुत ज़्यादा हमें इस पे focus नहीं करना कि इतने epochs, इतने ये, उसको हम randomly select करके बाद में tune भी कर सकते हैं. There are many things. But main thing is the cost should go down. So after every mini batch, you should plot the cost curve. जब एक mini batch गुजर जाए, plot the cost curve कि cost अभी तक कहाँ पहुँची है. It should taper down like this. So the cost is going to go down like this. It should go down like this. That means कि the system is learning. And when the cost saturates here, so you can stop. So ये तो बिल्कुल बच्चों वाली example है, जो MNIST वाली है. तो deep learning में ये बच्चों वाली example समझी जाती है. Because it's a solved process. Eh? Haan, chale, exercise. An extreme version of GD is to use a mini batch size of just one. Ye toh wahi wali baat hogi, purani wali, theek hai? Then we choose another training input and update the weights and biases again and so on repeatedly. This procedure is called as online learning or incremental learning. ये जो हम कह रहे हैं ना कि हर एक के बाद अपडेट करें, तो ये भी पूरी एक रिसर्च डोमेन खुल चुकी है. ऑनलाइन लर्निंग इसको कहते हैं, वी कॉल इट एज ऑनलाइन लर्निंग. इन ऑनलाइन लर्निंग अ न्यूरल नेटवर्क जस्ट लर्न्स फ्रॉम वन ट्रेनिंग इंस्टेंस. नेम वन एडवांटेज एंड वन डिसएडवांटेज ऑफ ऑनलाइन लर्निंग एज कंपेयर टू एसजीडी विद अ मिनी बैच साइज ऑफ से 20. व्हाट्स एडवांटेज? नहीं, ऑफ ऑनलाइन लर्निंग फास्टर. इट्स वेरी स्लो. इट इज स्लो बट इट इज इट लर्न्स मोर बिकॉज आई एम लर्निंग आफ्टर एवरी ट्रेनिंग इंस्टेंस, सो आई हैव मोर कंट्रोल ओवर द वेट्स. जी, ओवर क्यों होगी? मैं सिखा रहा हूं उसको, इसमें ओवर फिटिंग क्या है? नहीं, द मोर ट्रेनिंग डेटा द बेटर. डीप लर्निंग में तो जितना ट्रेनिंग डेटा दें, जितनी लर्निंग करें, इट्स बेटर. वो तो आपको समझाने के लिए सिर्फ, आपको समझ में आ गया होगा ना, आप ह्यूमन बीइंग ही है ना. आप तो ठीक,
जस्ट
ऑप्टिमाइज सम मेजर. हाँ देखें, ये तो सब बातें सही है. अभी हम इसकी एडवांटेज और डिसएडवांटेज की बात करते हैं. हाँ, लेकिन आप उसको एआई पर्सपेक्टिव से, नॉट विद द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ एआई, वी टॉक जस्ट अबाउट विद द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ वेट अपडेट्स एंड दोस थिंग्स, राइट? सो एडवांटेज क्या है ऑनलाइन लर्निंग का, कि आई एम लर्निंग आफ्टर एवरी ट्रेनिंग इंस्टेंस, सो आई एम लर्निंग इन अ बेटर वे. As far as overfitting is concerned, so we have some techniques to avoid that in deep learning. For example, we can use the concept of dropout. Dropout means ki I don't have to use all the neurons in learning. I can drop some of them stochastically. I can have a probability distribution of the neuron activations. Ab ye thoda sa advanced concept ho jayega ki neuron ki activations ki probability density main estimate kar lunga, aur us probability density se I can determine ke which are the neurons which I should shut down from time to time. Yani, who have a very low probability of firing. Because if a neuron fires, then the network learns. If a neuron does not fire, then that is not contributing to learning the network. So the neurons which typically do not fire can be shut down. Why do I have to update the weights for them? So that is the concept of dropout which we can use. We can also use the concept of batch normalization to avoid overfitting. So there are three or four types. We can also use regularization to avoid overfitting. But online learning is not overfitting. It's even, you can say it's better learning. So that's the disadvantage, advantage. What is the disadvantage? Anything else? Yeah, the performance can vary. परफॉर्मेंस का उसको स्टैंडर्डाइज, ऑल दो ऑनलाइन लर्निंग में आपको थोड़ा सा रिसर्च कीजिएगा, इट्स गोइंग बाय लीप्स एंड बाउंड्स अहेड, बट स्टिल देर आर कैवियट्स टू दैट के नो वन कैन गारंटी एनीथिंग अनलेस यू एक्सपेरिमेंट एंड सी इट. डीप लर्निंग का प्रॉब्लम यही है, इट्स जस्ट अ ब्लैक बॉक्स. बहरहाल इज जस्ट टू ब्रिंग टू योर नॉलेज के ऑनलाइन लर्निंग पे तो लोग अब थीसिस वगैरह पता नहीं क्या कुछ कर रहे हैं. Or isme you probably know about reinforcement learning, which is a part of machine learning. Reinforcement learning. In reinforcement learning as well, we do typically focus on online cue learning. You learn as soon as the knowledge comes in. As soon as you appear of some knowledge, you learn. So the system will take time to converge, but when it converges, it is your robotic systems hote hain which learn to navigate in different situations, to wo isi tarah learn karte hain. Yeah. No. We will update after every training instance. 784 to hamari majboori hai. We can't have less than that because we have 784 pixels. Nahi. Kahan likha hua? Learns from just one training input at a time. Ek input diya, update the weights and biases. Dusra input, update the weights and biases. Tisra input, update. So I update the weight and biases after every training instance. That's called online learning. Jitne pixels honge, utni input layer mein aapko dalna hoga neurons. There is no way out of that. Unless you decide, huh, there is a way out of that. Unless you first do image processing, identify the more concentrated areas of the image and only input those. But those, you have to fix the size. Ki bhai 784 mein I'm taking 16 by 16 jo beech ka hai. Wo upar asman hai, niche zameen hai. Bas beech ka jo image hai, mujhe usse farz hai. So I'm just taking 16 by 16, which are in the center. So in that case, the neurons will reduce. But that is not what we, is tarah se kaam chalta nahi hai. Typically, we process the image and input the whole image. So we can denoise the image or desaturate the image, whatever. Okay, BP was originally introduced in 1970s. At that time, jab BP aaya tha, to it was a lot of optimism. A lot of optimism was generated that, oh, now we can have robots and this and that. Okay. But there was a catch to it. Ke they were not able to, at that time, jo BP aaya tha, wo basically it had a lot of problems. I don't think so. It was based on gradient descent. They had some other, they knew that they wanted to backpropagate the error. Backpropagation ka matlab kya hai? I am propagating the error backwards through the layers. Now get this concept in mind. The error is where? At the output layer. Weights and biases are where? In the hidden layers. Okay. So I have to, how will I update the weights and biases? Obviously based on that error term or the cost term, sorry, cost term. So I have to find a way to bring back the cost layer by layer and update the weights accordingly. Yani, you can take the example like this. I am thinking ke, I am telling the weights and biases, yaar, tumhari wajah se ye masla khada ho gaya. Tumhari ye value thi, lihaza meri ye cost aa rahi hai, lihaza apni value ko change karo. You had this value. Based on that, I got this cost. I suffered a setback. Now change yourself. So I have to bring back the cost somehow so that based on the cost, I can update the what? Weights and biases. And that is exactly what is happening in this equation. This equation may dcx by dbl is the connection. This is bringing back the cost. The partial derivatives are the backpropagation stuff that we are doing. Okay. Sahi? Okay. So at that time, usme logon ne bahut sari optimism dikhaya. So people were not able to, the algorithms were not able to learn properly. We did not have that much application of sigmoid neurons in those days. Basically, it was the perceptron. And the things, itni cheeze baithi nahi. So inki funding, AI ki funding wagara bhi, it went down. Until 1986 mein, there was a paper by Geoffrey Hinton, who invented the restricted Boltzmann machines, which is also a generative model. David Rummel Hart and Ronald Williams. So they published a paper in which they proposed an extension of the backpropagation algorithm as we know today. And that worked pretty good. So that worked faster than earlier approaches to learning, making it possible to use neural networks to solve problems which had previously been insoluble. So as soon as they published this, though, in 1990s, when there was a huge stream of applications of optical bar recognition, optical character recognition. So there were lots and lots of multi-layer perceptrons, which were able to learn the barcodes, recognize barcodes, recognize digits, etc., etc. So zamane mein ye, abhi bhi bahut sare log is pe Urdu recognition pe aur Sindhi language recognition, English recognition pe kaam kar rahe hain. So it started in 1990s. After this 1986 algorithm came into picture. So today the BP is the workhorse of learning in neural networks. And at the heart of the backpropagation are this. The same things that we want to update the weights and biases. The partial derivatives of the cost with respect to weights and biases. Okay? Is this thing clear? That was just to give you knowledge. So now we don't get bogged down by this notation, because we're not going to be using this very frequently. I think we're going to be using this in only one slide. But we have to use a notation. You can invent your own notation as well to represent the weight. Because every weight synapse, a weight always occurs on a particular synapse, right? Okay. Is between two layers. Every synapse or every link is between two layers. So I have the previous layer and a next layer. Okay. So if I take this arrow, so this is between layer two and layer three, right? So I have to represent it somehow by a particular weight. So the notation that they have used in that book is WLJK, with this is W324. It means that the weight, this weight is going towards layer three. This weight is going towards, ignorant W is the weight from the kth neuron to the jth neuron. So layer three ki taraf ye ja raha hai, weight is going towards layer three. Okay. From the fourth neuron in the second layer to the second neuron in the third layer. Kya dobara sun? 1, 2, 3, 4. In layer two, I have four neurons. In layer three, I have two neurons. So this weight is going from the fourth neuron in layer two to the second neuron in layer three. So I represent that by 2, 4. Actually, ulta likha hua hai. Lekin ye ulta kisi wajah se likha hua hai. It should be 4, 2, like going from 4 to 2. It would have been easier to understand. So three is the main fulcrum there, right? Okay, three, I am going towards the layer three. So layer three mein, the neuron is number two, and I'm coming from layer two from the fourth neuron. Okay. Maybe iski wajah yahi ho. Acha, aur biases ko represent karne ke liye, I don't need three subscripts, I just need two. So this is the bias in the second layer of the third neuron. Kyunki the bias of the neuron is just input like this here. It's a separate input to each neuron. So I don't have the concept of the next layer or the previous layer. The bias is just one. So this neuron ko jo bias hai, the bias of this neuron is going to be represented by B23. That means the bias of the neuron of the third neuron in the second layer. Right? And what is A31? Activation of the first neuron in the third layer. So superscript is the number, layer number. Superscript is the layer number. Here it is the I'm going towards the third layer. Here I am in the second layer. Here I am in the third layer. And the subscript is basically the neuron number for activations and biases. For the weights, I have to represent one more because I'm going from one layer to the other layer. So itna zyada abhi isko hum istemal nahi karenge, because we are going to come to the vector notation very quickly. So if I want to represent the activation, I can represent it by this. Activation of the jth neuron in the lth layer is going to be, obviously, activation is going to be the output of sigma. What is this? Ye wo z hai jo maine aapko bataya. This is the z, which is the weighted input. We are going to be using z, lekin abhi bas aapko break up karke bata rahe hain. I am summing up all the neurons from the previous layer. Iska matlab yahan pe ye hoga ke weighted input ka kya matlab hai? Let's say I'm assuming this. So iski inputs kitni aa rahi hain? 4. That is why if I have to compute the total input for this, I have to sum up over 4. Okay. So this is the summation that is happening here. This is the summation. So for every neuron, I have to sum up over all its previous inputs. और वो मैंने ये नोटेशन डब्ल्यू एल जे के इन टू ए के एल माइनस वन, क्योंकि वाई मल्टीप्लाइड बाई ए, क्या बताया था मैंने आपको? यस आई टोल्ड यू के इफ आई हैव टू कंप्यूट फॉर दिस वन देन व्हाट इज कमिंग आउट ऑफ दिस एक्टिवेशन, कमिंग आउट ऑफ दिस एक्टिवेशन, आउट ऑफ दिस एक्टिवेशन एंड आउट ऑफ दिस ऑल्सो एक्टिवेशन. सो आई हैव फोर एक्टिवेशंस multiplied by the weights of these lines plus the bias of this neuron. That's it. Wx plus b, Wx plus b, Wx plus b in the vector notation. That's what you have to remember. Okay. So this is basically Wx plus b. Wa plus b, aap keh le isko. Okay. So if I, then I can represent it more in a better way. If I'm getting confused by these, so I can just represent WL. An activation of any neuron in the layer L is given by the weights of the previous, all the weights of the previous which are inputting to that neuron, multiplied by the activations which are coming from the previous layer plus the bias of that neuron. So ye vector ka matlab hai ki for all the neurons in that layer. So AL means the activations of all the neurons in layer L equals to the weight which are coming to each neuron, multiplied by the respective activations, multiplied by the bias of each neuron. Sahi hai? By the input value of the pixel, wo linear activation chala jayega bas. So I can, now I use the Z notation. So Z is basically WL AL minus 1 plus B. If Z क्या है, weighted input क्या, ये वो है जो neuron के अंदर आ रहा है, input पे जा रहा है, क्या जा रहा है, पिछले से activation multiplied by the weight plus the bias, और output पे क्या आ रहा है, AL आ रहा है, AL equals to sigma ZL, ये दोनों है, L का मतलब है layer number, so basically this is the vector which consists values for all the neurons, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, ठीक है, and these are the components of Z, but we are not bothered right now with it. You can just forget about this. So just remember this equation and this equation. Okay, so the formalism is very important. Ab jaldi jaldi chalte hain. Oh, L denotes the number of layers. Ye baat sab, total number of layers is L. Acha, ye cost function ab yahan par aaya hai. What does this represent?
See, it's the same cost function, but I am now representing that as the part of activation, because what is coming out of the output layer are the activations. Output layer ke jo bahar cheez aayegi, which I am going to compare with the actual value, are the activations. So ALX ka matlab kya hai? This is not OLX. ALX, output layer. This is the output. Cost is computed at the output layer only, not at the hidden layer. So ALX ka matlab ye hai there ke the vector of activations at of the output layer. अगर आउटपुट लेयर में 10 न्यूरॉन्स हैं, तो AL वेक्टर में कितनी एंट्रीज होंगी? इफ द 10 वेक्टर मींस द सारे न्यूरॉन्स का इकट्ठा एक वेक्टर में, इसलिए ये तो सही है, ये लिख कर देख के दिखाओ. तो ALX इज द वेक्टर ऑफ एक्टिवेशंस आउटपुट ऑफ द नेटवर्क व्हेन X इज द इनपुट, व्हिच इज द इमेज ऑफ इनपुट किया. नाउ आई टेक टू अजम्पशंस. Assumption one is that the cost function to be written as an average, and we know the reason for that now because of the mini batch. Okay, mini batch mein I will compute the cost for each instance, but I will take the average at the end and then update the weights. Okay, so I compute the cost as an average. This average is over the cost of all the training examples, and cost for the single training example is CX, which is what we know how to calculate that now. So why we need this assumption? Because BP allows us to compute DCX by DW and DCX by DP for a single training instance, and we recover the whole by averaging over all the training examples. So the assumption is that if I take the average cost, then if I update the mini batch after the if I update the network after the mini batch, then the partial derivatives that I'm going to have are basically the approximations of the individual partial derivatives that I would have achieved
had I used each training instance separately. मैं ये भी तो कर सकता था ना, ऑनलाइन लर्निंग का सिनेरियो कर लूं. ऑनलाइन लर्निंग में आई एम गोइंग टू बी हैविंग पार्शियल डेरिवेटिव्स आफ्टर ईच ट्रेनिंग इंस्टेंस, राइट? बट आई एम नॉट डूइंग दैट नाउ इन एसजीपी. आई एम अपडेटिंग द वेट्स आफ्टर द मिनी बैच. सो माय अजम्पशन इज द सेम. एवरेज कॉस्ट कन्वर्जेस टू द कॉस्ट व्हिच वुड हैव बीन इन द ट्रू केस, एंड द पार्शियल डेरिवेटिव्स कन्वर्ज टू द पार्शियल डेरिवेटिव्स व्हिच वुड हैव बीन देयर फॉर ईच सिंगल इंस्टेंस सेपरेट. Okay, so that is the assumption. So that's why we need to take the average. So basically, I can say Cx equals to C, because I'm assuming that Cx individual cost is going to be approximated by that true cost. Okay, when I take the average. So that's the first assumption that we have. And now the second is that write the cost as a function of the outputs of the network. So we have already done that, right? We already done that. Yj minus Alj. Yj is a constant, which is the actual output, which we already know. And ALJ is simply the output from the,
I just want to write the cost as a function of the activation,
rather than saying something else or whatever. So I just use the activation. So Y is a fixed parameter. We have nothing to do with that. It's just a constant for us, okay? And then we have this Hadamard. Hadamard product is, Hadamard product is represented by this circle, and inside a circle it's a dot. That's called a Hadamard product. So this is the element wise product of the two vectors. Element wise ka matlab hai ki position ke hisab se karo, right? So 1 multiplied 1 Hadamard 3 is what? 1 into 3 and 2 into 4, so 3, 8. As simple as that. So element wise product or Hadamard product. ठीक है. नाम तो बड़ा complicated है, लेकिन काम बहुत ही simple है. ठीक है. So we have this. This is the NumPy में ये बच्चों वाली चीज है. ठीक है. NumPy, when you use NumPy, अभी जाने की कोशिश ना करें. अभी तो काम शुरू हुआ है. Now अब काम शुरू हुआ है. Now the work has started. Okay. So I will tell you the basic idea here, which will help you, inshallah, to understand the slides in a better way. So assume that we have a demon here, okay? But it's a good demon for some reason. Okay. अब हो ही रहा है कि we know that in order to update the weights and biases, we have to compute these. ये तो पता है ना, main तो हमारा मकसद यही है, फिर हम update कर सकते हैं आराम से. So in order to अब हम देखें हमने इस बात को प्रूव किया है by using some intelligent substitution के the rate of change of weights and biases is going to definitely influence the cost by using that function, which is delta c equals to inverted c multiplied by delta v. We use that thing, right? But we have to make it more formal now in the form of partial derivatives. So, अब हम चाह रहे ये हैं कि रेट ऑफ चेंज ऑफ वेट्स एंड बायसेस, रेट ऑफ चेंज ऑफ कॉस्ट को किसी तरह आपस में जोड़ा जाए. वी वॉन्ट टू हैव अ सेंट्रल मिडल वेयर सॉर्ट ऑफ थिंग. हम एक कॉन्सेप्ट बीच में चाहते हैं विच कैन हेल्प मी कंट्रोल एग्जैक्टली द रेट ऑफ चेंज ऑफ कॉस्ट विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द रेट ऑफ चेंज ऑफ वेट्स एंड बायसेस. समझ आ रही बात की? सो सिर्फ ये कॉन्सेप्ट याद रखें कि आई एम इंट्रोड्यूसिंग अ न्यू टर्म हियर व्हिच इज गोइंग टू मेक माय जॉब मच 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 इजियर इन डूइंग बैक प्रोपोगेशन. वेरी इजी इन फैक्ट, अदरवाइज इट वुड नॉट बी इजी. अब वो टर्म क्या है? आई कॉल दैट एज द एरर टर्म व्हिच इज डेल्टा एल जे. डेल्टा एल मीन्स ऑब्वियसली एरर इन द लेयर एल, एंड जे मीन्स फॉर द न्यूरॉन. So if this is the layer 2 and this is the third neuron, so this is delta 2, 3. The error term in the second layer at the third neuron, like the activation and the bias. Okay, sahi hai. Now, what do you mean by the error? Because yahan par to hum cost ki baat kar rahe hain. We're talking about the cost here, right? So error ka kya matlab hai? We'll discuss that. Error yahan par ek alag cheez hai. और कॉस्ट एक अलग चीज है. ठीक है. कॉस्ट तो वो है कि भाई मुझे तो ये चीज नजर आ रही है, तुमने तो भाई आउटपुट पे तो किया है. कॉस्ट तो वो चीज है. एरर वो चीज है कि वेट्स एंड बायसेस को अंदाजा बताया जा रहा है. वी आर टेलिंग द वेट्स एंड बायसेस कि हाउ मच यू आर स्टिल फार अवे फ्रॉम योर गोल. इट्स जस्ट अ कॉन्सेप्ट दैट वी हैव इंट्रोड्यूस्ड अवरसेल्व्स. लाइक वी सेड कि डेल्टा वी इक्वल्स टू माइनस ईटा मल्टीप्लाइड बाय इनवर्टेड सी. वी इंट्रोड्यूस द कॉन्सेप्ट अवरसेल्व्स, राइट, वो जो हमने सब्स्टिट्यूशन की. सो जस्ट रिमेंबर दिस कि एवरी न्यूरॉन बिसाइड्स द इनपुट लेयर ऑब्वियसली every neuron in the hidden and output layer has an error term associated with it. We do it ourselves, which we are representing by delta lj. Okay, sahi. Now what does this mean? The bp will help us to calculate the error, which will help us to compute the aforementioned partial derivatives. Through the backpropagation, we are going to calculate a value for this error. If we are able to calculate a value for this error, it will help us calculate the values of these partial derivatives extremely easily. Okay, so let's just stick with there. I will just tell you how this happens. So assume that we have this daemon. The daemon is the error, in fact. The daemon is the error, okay, which is sitting at the jf neuron in the lf layer. Okay, which is simple enough to understand now. As the input to the neuron comes in, jaise iska z aata hai, as the z comes in here, what does the daemon do? Messes with it by adding delta z lj, because z aa raha hai na input pe. To wo kya karta hai ki wo z total to aa raha hai, weighted input is coming, it just adds an other term to z, it just adds a small delta to it and increases it or decreases whatever. Delta can be negative bhi ho sakta hai, positive bhi ho sakta hai, but the point is ke the error term ka matlab kya hai ki whatever the weighted input is coming in, I add something to it and then send it to the sigmoid function to compute the activation. Sahi hai? Is this thing clear? So instead of having zj,
I am having zj plus delta z.
That's it. Sahi hai? This is the concept that I've introduced. Just abhi sunte jaye, theek hai? The daemon messes with it by adding delta zlg, because lj is the same subscript now, theek hai? To the neuron's weighted input z. So zlg plus delta zlg, zlj plus delta zlg. Okay, why do we do that? So instead of outputting sigma zlj, it outputs sigma zlj plus delta zlg. So basically what the daemon is doing is that it is trying to mess with the weighted input by changing it and then giving it to that. Now this concept of change is what is going to help me reduce the cost function down. क्योंकि देखें हमने सिंपली किया ये, एंड दिस डीमन विल गो हियर विल गो हियर विल गो हियर विल गो हियर ऑन ऑल द न्यूरॉन्स बिसाइड्स द इनपुट लेयर एंड इट इज गोइंग टू कंप्यूट इट्स एरर टर्म. ठीक है, सो दैट्स अभी तक इतना रखे विद लेवल टेन. दिस प्रोपोगेट्स थ्रू द लेयर्स अंटिल द कॉस्ट चेंजेस बाय एन अमाउंट डेल्टा सी बाय डेल्टा जेड जे डेल्टा जेड. अब समझ आई आपको कि जब इस डीमन ने when he adds another term to that, what happens at the end is ke the cost will change because you brought the change here, you changed the weighted input, so definitely that is going to affect the cost. I want to have control over that, so therefore that control is provided by this delta z. So the cost is going to change by dc over d, or the cost is varying with respect to the weighted input. You see, I can compute the cost with respect to z, I can compute the cost with respect to a, because I can represent the cost in terms of a as well as I can represent the cost in terms of z. If I want to compute dc by dz, I can do that. If I want to compute dc by da, I can do that. Sahi hai? So main kar sakta hu. So let's assume ke agar maine yahan ke upar delta z lg kisi neuron pe add kiya, I added that, then what is going to happen is it is going to definitely affect this quantity by this amount. That is going to happen, right? Because I changes the weighted input, so the rate of change of cost with respect to the weighted input is going to change by this amount. Jab maine yahan pe delta z lg add kiya, so the rate of change of cost with respect to z is also going to change. How much it is going to change? With respect by this much. So I am saying bc by dc over multiplied by delta z. ये वही चीज है जो हम पहले पढ़ रहे थे, k ये रेट ऑफ द चेंज इन कॉस्ट इज एस्टिमेटेड बाय dc by dw1 multiplied by delta w1 plus dc by dw2 multiplied by delta w2. So this is it. Okay, so is the concept clear? The concept of the daemon is that it is going to basically mess with the weighted input, add to that a term which is definitely going to change the partial derivative of cost with respect to the weighted input. So okay, the change of cost, it is going to affect how much the cost is going to change with respect to the weighted input. Because my weighted input bhi change kiya hai na. Therefore, the rate of change of the change of cost with respect to the weighted input is going to change. So basically, what it means is that
delta C will be approximated by dc by dt into delta Lj.
So the way the cost is changing with respect to the weighted input is going to change when I mess with this. So again, I will repeat K, I can derivate the cost with respect to weighted input. I can derivate the cost with respect to Z. It's matlab ek hi baat hai, A is sigma of Z. So main, jab main yahan pe weighted input change karta hun, so the way the cost is changing with respect to the weighted input is also going to change. So this is the flexibility I wanted. Okay, by introducing a term here, I am having an influence on the cost. Samajh aayi baat ki? So there. So ek do slide dekh lete hain.
So I just so actually the daemon, ye wahi cheeze jo maine upar padhai hai, is copied from the last slide. Actually, the daemon is trying to help you lower the cost just as you want. That's what it's trying to do. It's trying to help you. By introducing the extra delta Z here, it's having an impact on the cost so that you can lower the cost. Okay, that's what you need to keep in mind.
If the rate of change of cost with respect to the activation is large, either positive or negative, then the cost can be lowered by choosing ZLJ to have an opposite sign to the partial derivative. Do you understand now? Samajhai kya likha hua hai? Ki agar कॉस्ट का डेरिवेटिव इधर से इनपुटेशन अगर ये ज्यादा हो गया सो हाउ कैन वी लोअर द कॉस्ट क्या क्या आ रहा था
If it is very small,
the cost can be controlled by the amount delta Z energy is adding. So that is the way that daemon is trying to make. Daemon is only introducing the delta Z term. The delta Z term is having an impact on the cost. If the partial derivative of cost with respect to the activation, with respect to the weighted input is very high, then we can have a negative value of delta Z and that is going to bring the cost down. If the partial derivative is very low, then we can either choose to have a very small delta Z or we can choose to do nothing. Because already my is being satisfied. Okay? So, what we have understood is that we just have a mechanism of influencing the cost based on changes in the weighted input. Sahi hai? Ye concept to clear hai na sabko? So now you see ke ab aap dekhiye, now you should be able to understand. We define the error of neuron J in layer L by delta Lj equals to dc over dz Lj. So this is the term that we are calling that as the energy. This term we are calling that as the energy. Okay. Where delta n is the vector of errors associated with the layer L. So this is the whole vector. BP will help us find delta L for each layer. The backpropagation will help us find delta L for each layer, for the output layer, for hidden layer, number 1, 2, 3, whatever. And then the relating those errors to the PDs of our intersection, this and this, of our interest, this and this. So how does this happen?
So the error term
is what? वो जो उसका deltas, उसका उससे क्या ताल्लुक था? So it's adding this delta z lj, right? और हम क्या कह रहे हैं कि this is the error term. We introduce the error term, right? So delta lj is the error term. So the rate of change of cost with respect to the activation. So इसको थोड़ा सा कोई समझने की कोशिश करेंगे कि rate of change of cost with respect to the weighted input is the error term. So what about if this is the case, then what about delta z lj that we were doing? क्योंकि इसके अंदर ही वो चेंज आ रहा है ना. जब मैंने यहां पे चेंजेस किए, जब मैंने यहां पे चेंजेस किए तो आई एम कंप्यूटिंग द पार्शियल डेरिवेटिव एट द आउटपुट लेयर, राइट? ठीक है, तो कॉस्ट जो जेड एल जे है उसके अंदर ही वो चेंजेस आ रहे हैं जो मैंने किए हैं बेसिकली. ठीक है, सो आई एम रिप्रेजेंटिंग दैट बाय दिस. तो बेसिकली द एरर मींस द रेट ऑफ चेंज ऑफ कॉस्ट विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द वेटेड इनपुट व्हिच इंक्लूड्स द चेंजेस आई हैव डन. सो यहां पे जो भी मैं जेड एल को चेंज करूंगा, डीमन जो चेंज करेगा, दैट इज गोइंग टू अफेक्ट द एरर, द एरर टर्म. ठीक है, सो इज द वेक्टर. और फिर क्या है, when we find out the rate of change of cost with respect to each activation layer, so that is going to help us estimate the things that we want here actually. So we'll see how that happens. wo hum isko dekhenge ki ye kis tarah calculate ho, because main maqsad to hamara yahi hai na, cost with respect to weight and cost with respect to mass, that's what we have to estimate, that's our main point of interest. So for that to happen, I just introduced this error term which is equal to the partial derivative of cost with respect to the activation function. Bas ye abhi yaad rakhein, theek hai? So this is calculated for each neuron because at each neuron I am having an activation, weighted input. At each neuron I am having a weighted input, of the hidden layer and the output layer. At each neuron I am having a weighted input, so therefore I can compute this partial derivative term for each neuron and that will be the error term. तो थ्रू बैक प्रोपगेशन इफ आई एम एबल टू एस्टिमेट द एरर टर्म, इफ आई एम एबल टू एस्टिमेट द एरर टर्म फॉर ईच न्यूरॉन, देन दैट इज एरर टर्म इज गोइंग टू हेल्प मी एस्टिमेट द वैल्यू ऑफ डीसी ओवर डीडब्ल्यू एंड डीसी ओवर डीबी. सो दैट इज द कनेक्शन दैट यू नीड टू कीप इन माइंड. सही है, हाँ ये आप, ये पूरी इक्वेशन अभी आई है ना, बस ये आखिरी है, उसके बाद तो खैर वो हमारी तो दिस इज नॉट इक्वेशन वन, राइट? हाँ दिस इज इक्वेशन, तो जस्ट दिस इज द लास्ट वन. ओके, एरर टर्म का कॉन्सेप्ट समझ में आ गया? क्या है एरर टर्म? Yes, it is something that I can introduce or I have introduced which will help me control the cost in a better way. ठीक है, so now let's define it formally. अब उसकी main formula अभी आया है, ठीक है? जी. Because I'm seeing a delta lj. Every neuron in the hidden layer, yes, there will be an error. That is only for our understanding. Separately, हर neuron के लिए separately computed. So the backpropagation algorithm is based around four fundamental equations. अगर आपने वो चार इक्वेशंस आपने समझ ली तो यू विल अंडरस्टैंड हाउ द बीपी वर्क्स एंड दोस फोर इक्वेशंस आर प्रीटी सिंपल नॉट वेरी डिफिकल्ट फ्रॉम विच वी कैन कंप्यूट डेल्टा एल एंड द ग्रेडियंट ऑफ द कॉस्ट फंक्शन विच इज व्हाट वी वांट सो द फर्स्ट इक्वेशन इज विच इज द लास्ट थिंग दैट वी डू टुडे इज द एरर टर्म सो द एरर टर्म इज डिफाइंड बाय सो दिस इज इनफैक्ट हम ये तो हम बात कर रहे थे ना कि डेल्टा एल जे इक्वल्स टू डी सी ओवर डी जी ये हमने बात की थी ना अभी कि डेरिवेटिव ऑफ कॉस विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द वेटेड इनपुट ठीक है अब हम इसको मजीद फॉर्मली डिफाइन कर देते हैं विच वी कैन एक्चुअली यूज सो इट इज दिस इक्वेशन ठीक है सो डेरिवेटिव ऑफ कॉस विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द एक्टिवेशन विच इज कमिंग आउट ऑफ दैट मल्टीप्लाइड बाय द सिग्मॉइड फंक्शन का डेरिवेटिव ऑफ द इनपुट So if you take the visual representation for that, visually you can represent it like this. I have
some lower and some here. I am having set J here because this is a J now, and out of it I am having A. And let's say this is the layer number A, and this is also the layer number A. So I'm interested in computing delta LJ. So that is given by the partial derivative of cos with respect to the activation. The activation, because I can represent the cost in terms of activation. Assumption number one. I will represent the cost in terms of the activation or the activation value. So I can find out the derivative of this equation. And multiplied by the derivative of the sigmoid function. Sigmoid function is called 1 over gamma plus root 2 of minus x. So I can take the derivative of that. Uska derivative hum lenge to derivative we input this. Okay. So ye wo equation hai jo humne khud create ki. What is this telling me?
This particular neuron
at that particular neuron. How much the cost is varying with respect to the activation of the neuron? We want to have control over this thing. And what is this telling you? A sigmoid function ka derivative kya hota hai? 1 over 1 plus e to the minus x ka derivative kya hoga? Okay. Derivative of the cost, derivative of the sigmoid function means ke how much the value is changing with respect to the weighted input. Because whenever I want to ask such a question, how much it is changing, I have to take the derivative. So forget about the fact that the derivative kya hai. I'm just taking the derivative of that. Here I want to understand ki us neuron ke upar cost kitni change ho rahi hai with respect to the activation value of that neuron. And here I am trying to understand ke what effect it is having on the sigmoid function. इस सिग्मॉइड फंक्शन के हिसाब से वेटेड इनपुट सिग्मॉइड फंक्शन को कितना इन्फ्लुएंस कर रहा है यू अंडरस्टैंड के यानी सिग्मॉइड फंक्शन किस हिसाब से इस वेटेड इनपुट के चेंज हो रहा है हाउ मच दिस वेटेड इनपुट इज इन्फ्लुएंसिंग द आउटपुट वैल्यू ऑफ द सिग्मॉइड फंक्शन फॉर दैट आई हैव टू टेक द डेरिवेटिव ऑफ द सिग्मॉइड फंक्शन
represents the actual
output. DA over DZ because activation is represented by the sigmoid function so DA over DZ means the derivative of the sigmoid function. Yes that's true wo bhi chain rule ke andar aa jayega wo cheez DA over DZ so abhi isko yahi tak rehne dete this is the first fundamental equation actually we have four of them I will just show them to you so these are the four equations pehli wali to wahi hai this is the second one jisme hamdard product aapko mil raha hai This is the third one, which is what we want. Okay, dc over dv and dc over dw. So now you can see that I can represent dc over dv by the error term, which we computed earlier. And I can represent dc over dw again by the error term multiplied by. So then I have to say that the error term, which we introduced, is going to help us find out the value of these partial derivatives. So that is what it is. Okay. So I just had to do some sort of maths to estimate that, which estimated that day. DC over DA multiplied by the DA over DZ job carry. Yeah. And I can just, I can prove it mathematically that this is true. We're not going to do the proof, but this can be proven that this is true. Okay.
So, analytical हमने खुद बनाया
जी 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 अभी
आर 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 हमने सेलेक्ट
किया वी जस्ट इंट्रोड्यूस दिस फार्मूला दैट फार्मूला देयर जो कि मैंने अभी आपको पढ़ाया है दैट फार्मूला इज बेसिकली हेल्पिंग अस टू कंप्यूट द वैल्यू ऑफ पी फॉर सेट दैट इज व्हाट वी वांट ओके सो ये तो फिर हम जरा तफसील में इक्वेशंस पढ़ लेंगे तो आई थिंक वी कैन हैव अ अदर क्लास ऑन संडे नाइट 1.5 आवर्स टू फिनिश दिस साढ़े नौ ग्यारह बजे तक सैटरडे नहीं है सैटरडे मेरा बहुत भारी दिन होता है मेरी उसे डिप्लोमा की क्लास होती है सही है इज दिस थिंग क्लियर सो द बेसिक आइडिया दैट यू नीड टू कीप इन माइंड इज दैट वी इंट्रोड्यूस दिस डेल्टा एल जे वेयर एल इज फॉर ऑल द लेयर्स सो इसकी हम तफसील पढ़ेंगे तो आपको समझ आए बट द बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट इज कि बेस्ड ऑन द वैल्यू ऑफ डेल्टा I can compute the partial directness which I want. Activation to mere paas hai. What's the problem with that? I can compute the activation through the sigmoid function. But based on the value of delta Lj, I can compute both the partial derivatives, which will help me update the values of weights and biases. That's it. That's the basic concept. So in the book that we are following, so they have adopted this notation. Otherwise, people can tell you about the chain rule and all those other things, but this is going to help you understand things in a better and a more logical way. It's a very famous online book. Jisse main isko follow kar raha hu. Neural networks and deep learning team by Nelson Nielsen or something like that. I'm taking exactly the same examples because usne bahut clearly aur ek ek step karke alag alag samjhaya hua hai. Last time I taught deep learning, that was like maybe I taught backpropagation in just one class or I just wrote a few equations of a chain rule and that was it. But उसमें थिंकिंग डेवलप नहीं हुई थी बच्चों की यू नीड टू थिंक व्हाट्स हैपनिंग बिकॉज मे बी यू विल बी आस्क्ड टू डिजाइन यू नो जस्ट फिनिश द रिकॉर्डिंग